even travel NBC and had to call AT&T to get a international feature on my phone. A lot of folks, even the people there, are, is it safe to go down there? Aren't you scared? No. Got all kind of warnings even before we left. And we hear of Mexico and the things in the news, the drug and all like that. But I want to tell you, it's a good place to go, to visit, to get outside. So we had a good time. But the reason why I'm saying that is that God has given us life. And he's given us life in the fullness, praise God. And I actually thought safer over there than I did on 46th Street North. Hallelujah. But God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and of what kind of mind? A sound mind. Praise God. Hallelujah. He says, fear no evil. Praise God. It's good to be with people as we travel. A couple that I happen to have a seat with next to on the plane said, I said, oh, what? They said, oh, where you stand in Cancun while you're here? And I said, at the Beach Palace Resort. He said, oh, great. I said, how about you? He said, we're going to rent a house here while we're here. And what that let me know was that they have plenty of provisions that they're going to rent somebody's house to be on vacation down here. But we had a good time. You see the ocean as far as you can see to meet the sky? How many know what I'm talking about? Blue, praise God. We had an opportunity to swim with the dolphins, but we didn't do that. But we just had a great, great time. And as I looked in that ocean and played in it, I said, you know, God made this for us to play playgrounds of the world. And we have to buy into the reality that God doesn't want us under a lot of stress and pull and worry and all kinds of things. He gave us life, and all those negatives were not a part of, was no component of life. Life is your joy, our joy, being full. Remember, there's the enemy that doesn't want you to enjoy, or any of us to really enjoy life. He wants us crammed and limited, and the whole idea. So I'm going to show you today, hopefully through God's word, this life is in the sun, what the sun has to say about it. And course, for I begin, St. John, the 10th chapter. While I was away, I had my son-in-law, Walter, feed my guard dog. He's absolutely that, guard dog. He's a German Shepherd, over 100 pounds. And he will eat you alive if you don't belong. Come to see my dog, I think. He's for real, praise God. And so I had to have my son-in-law. I said, now here's what he does. He takes this drumstick, and anytime I give him anything like to dry it off, he's going to take it, he's going to go to a certain spot in the yard, and he's going to eat it. And when he does that, then you get his dish, and then you fill up the dry food, and you come out into the house. By no means do you step out into the backyard. And you do that while I'm on vacation, and we're going to be cool. And he did that, and it was cool. But here's what I said, I have to say this, is that my voice, the words that come from my voice, my dog will do. And it's simply because he is acquainted, and he knows that my voice has affection for him. I don't have to really holler or yell or even be physical with him since a pup. He was raised up to be a guard dog, a protector of me and Candy, and that's what he does, and he responds to my voice. And he trusts my voice. Now, I say that to say all of this to you is because we have to get acquainted with the voice of God. Because there's many sounds in the world. I mentioned this in Sunday school this once. Many sounds in the world. And you could get caught listening to the wrong sound. And every sound is not for your benefit. Every sound doesn't love you. Every sound would not die for you, give us life for you. And when Jesus said that I am come that you might have life, and have it more abundantly, He's saying that if you, as you listen to me, you will experience life in its fullness. Because he's saying that's what I want you to have, is life in its fullness. And really enjoy life. Okay, so let's look at St. John, the 10th chapter. And let's see what the scriptures are saying for us today. Kind of lengthy, but I'll share with you as limited as I can what the scriptures are saying so that we won't be burdened with reading. St. John 10:1, verily I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a what? And a robber. Okay, and verse 5, a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him. For they know not the voice of what?
Strangers.
And he's talking about his sheep in verse 3. To him the porter opened, the sheep hear his voice, he called his own sheep by name, and lead them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he go before them, and the sheep follow him, and they know his voice. Can we say amen?
Amen.
Praise God. So the sheep are in this particular pen, or this particular pasture, or however you call it. These animals, they know the voice of a shepherd. And the shepherd would go around them, and he'll call them all by name. He knows your name. James, Ken, Mary, come with me. I'm here. He's talking. They immediately start following his voice. And he goes before them. And he knows that they're going to follow his voice. And they are confident that this shepherd has their best welfare in mind. Now, here's what we have to come and understand, that sometimes that shepherd would take them to some tough crossings, dangerous looking situations. But they have no concern because they know that the shepherd has got them covered. I'm going to say, man, you know what I'm talking about. So he says, verse 5, that a stranger that will not follow. They're not going to follow a strange voice. They're going to run from him, for they don't know his voice. And then verse 7, Jesus explains exactly what he's trying to say. Verily I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that came before me are thieves and robbers. But the sheep did not hear them. I'm the door. Verse 10. The thief cometh not, but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, that they might have it how more abundantly. Now what is abundant living? Abundant living is absolutely more than enough. Is this really necessary?
Don't make any difference.
More than you need. More than you need. And we were studying in class this morning. Well, it's only one tree. How many trees in the Garden of Life? And y'all kicked that around last week when I wasn't around. How many trees was it in the Garden of Eden? Well, one tree, two trees, and one on each side of the room. And we come to find out. Praise God. We read our Bibles. Abundance of trees in the garden. The Garden of Eden. A tree for you to eat off of, to get nourishment. A tree for you to eat off of, to get health. A tree for you to eat off of, just to get glad. Plenty of trees. Whatever you want, go to that tree and get it. I'm telling you today, Jesus says that I'm coming that you might have life and have it what? Not only was the tree of life in that garden, but there was, not only did you get life when you got saved, but you also wasn't only the God kind of life, everlasting life, but there's more to everlasting life. There's a God kind of life. Having fun, health, wellness, praise God, peace of mind. I am come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. But the thief, there's a thief out there that wants you to enjoy life. He wants you to accept the other sounds of the voices in the world. There's a sound of the voice in the world that you have to experience sickness because that's part of life. Nowhere does God say that you have to be sick. Hallelujah. But we hear all these sounds. You have to be poor for you. What? No. And while I was on vacation, sitting on the beach, all these rich folks around me, my thought was, this is how God wants life. I have never had to sweat, toil for anything until after you were sin. This is how God wants life. Abundant, peaceful, enjoying the fruit of everything that he has. This is how God wants life. But as we go through life, we hear all the different sounds in the world that get your focus off of the kind of life that Jesus wants us to have, which is life in abundance, the God kind of life. Let me read some scriptures and see how Jesus tried to get this. Now, the reason why I'm telling you this is that in man, it's built in us as human beings a particular yearning. And that yearning can only be filled with the right type of affection. And if I don't sense that affection, I'm going to go looking for it somewhere, because that's how I'm designed as a human being, is that I need affection. You need affection. You need to know that someone loves you, someone cares for you. And even more, you need to know that someone laid down his life for you, that you might have life. And now, how deep is the measure of that love? It's unmeasurable. Let's look at a simple verse. We all know it, John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He so loved you and I. He has such that type of affection. And that's what my German shepherd know about me, is that he'll go the distance for me. And you gotta know that also about your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He went the what? Distance for me. He even died for me. If he dare die for me, then how much life did he want me to experience? Hallelujah. Let's look at the word once again, praise God. It says in St. John 10:14, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep,